go to the election campaign now, and Treasurer Josh Frydenberg joins us. Treasurer, good morning to you. Thanks for your time this morning. Lots to discuss if we can crack on. A report this morning, US envoy won't rule out military action against the Solomon Islands if China establishes a defence base there. Is that true? I mean, it's quite the missile across their bow.
Well, obviously, I'd leave it to the Americans to put more detail behind that statement, but what I can say is there is deep concern, not only here in Australia, but amongst our allies, the most important of which is the United States, about this closer relationship between the Solomon Islands and China. It's something that didn't seem to worry Richard Miles when he made that speech in China and provided a copy to the Chinese embassy before it, but it does concern us, and that is why we'll continue to engage with the Solomons, but also more broadly the Pacific family.
Okay, our spokesperson for Xi Jinping late last night said there's no way they're building a base. Do you believe them?
I think that they do want to build closer strategic and security ties, and that's what's of concern to us. As to how it would develop over the future is yet to be known, but the fact that the Solomon Islands and China have entered into this agreement is not a positive development, and it does create a more unstable region.
OK, let's talk about the war inside your own party now, the coalition. Matt Canavan yesterday just lighting everything up like a Christmas tree. Net zero is dead. That must be music to your ears.
Well, net zero is a commitment by the coalition that is clear, that is firm, and that is non-negotiable. This is not breaking news from Matt Canavan. This is old news. He's held that position for some time, but it's not the position of his party, it's not the position of my party, and it's not the position of the coalition. What we are doing is meeting our commitments under the Paris Agreement to reduce emissions by 26 to 28% by 2030 on the levels they were in 2005. Right now, Australia's emissions are down by 20% in New Zealand. They are out down by just 4%, in Canada by just 1%. And we have a technology investment roadmap, Carl, where we're putting more than $20 billion of taxpayers' money into new investments in technology and renewables so that we can meet that target.
It's pretty easy, though. If I'm going up against you in Kooyong and I'm the Climate 200 candidate, Monique Wright, a vote for the coalition is a vote for Matt Canavan.
A vote for Monique Ryan is a vote for Anthony Albanese and the Labor Party. I'm up against a fake independent who's a former member of the Labor Party, something they sought to conceal. They have no plan to meet emissions reduction targets. They have no details. They have no costings. They're literally the vibe of the thing. They're just a slogan and a billboard. There's nothing behind it, whereas we've got that technology investment roadmap which has more than $20 billion of taxpayers' money put to work, leveraging more than $80 billion of the private sector's investment.
Be honest with me, Treasurer. I mean, when you're up against the Climate 200 candidate and she's tracking well, you're behind in the polls. This from Matt Canavan could not have come at a worse time for you.
Like I said, it's old news. He's held that position. What really matters is the position of the coalition, and both the Prime Minister and the Deputy Prime Minister reaffirmed that commitment just yesterday. So we are on track to meet and beat our emissions reduction targets. But if you vote for these fake independents, you're more likely to get a hung parliament and the chaos and the confusion that comes with that. And to be honest with you, Carl, you've seen that movie before. You saw it with Labor and the Greens and Oakeshott and Windsor, and it was chaos and confusion. And the first question you asked me today was about national security. Well, probably the next question you're going to ask me is about the economy. These are big issues.
I can see you getting fired up, but I will beg to differ on one thing. I remember very clearly when the independents held the balance of power, and Rob Oakeshott, who wasn't independent, the streets of Port Macquarie were lined with gold.
Well, I can tell you they voted him out. So, you know, that didn't work out too well.
All right, you're going to debate Monique Wright. Are you worried about your own seat deep down?
Well, a couple of things. I've accepted the two invitations to debate Monique Ryan. One is in a People's Forum from Sky and the other is from Channel 9 in the studio. She rejected the invitation from Channel 9 to debate me in front of Chris Orman. I was happy to, no doubt, on a broad range of issues. Climate is one important issue. There are lots of other important issues at stake at the upcoming election. I don't take my seat for granted, Carl. I've been fortunate to be elected by the people of Kooyong four times. I'm from my electorate, I'm for my electorate, and I continue to work hard in my electorate. I don't take anything for granted, and the election will be close, and that's why people need to understand if you vote for a fake independent, the likelihood of a hung parliament and the chaos and confusion at a time when Australia needs stability and strength is more likely.
Should be an interesting debate between you and Monique Ryan a little bit later in the week. Good on you, Treasurer. Thanks for your time today. Appreciate it.
Well, I don't reckon the Prime Minister is too happy this morning. His hard-fought deal on net zero emissions appearing to fall apart after National Senator Matt Canavan declared the 2050 target's dead. And the man himself, the troublemaker, Matt Canavan, joins us now, along with editor of Body and Soul and Stella magazine, Sarah Lamarqua. Nice to see
you both
this morning. I mean, Matt. It was all calm. There was consensus on climate policy. And what do? You blow it up.
Look, Ali, my view should be no surprise to anybody. And my assessment, for what it's worth, is the rest of the world is doing nothing to go towards net zero emissions. About the only country doing something in the world is Afghanistan, and they're not installing a lot of renewable energy. It's not for that reason. I mean, what country in the world is doing anything? And if net zero is alive and kicking, show me where countries are doing that. If net zero is alive and kicking, why are European countries desperate for our coal right now? And so I think right now, in the time of where we're facing Chinese aggression in our region, we've got to focus on real things to protect this country. When other countries are doing the same, the UK's drilling for oil, Germany's opening up coal plants again. And what we should be doing is avoiding another carbon tax. The Labor Party want to put a new carbon tax on us, this environment. And I don't know what the inflation number is going to be today. All I know is that inflation is going to be higher under a Labor government when it imposes a carbon tax.
Look, I mean, Matt, though, this issue had sort of gone away. It had been sidelined a little bit because you had both Labor and the Coalition agreeing to 2050. And then you've done this. I mean, have you heard from the Prime Minister yet? I doubt he's happy with you.
Well, look, I'm not focused on the Prime Minister or me or anyone else in Canberra. I'm focused on the jobs and cost of living pressures on Australian families. That's my focus. I'm here at the Gracemere Sale Yards today, where a whole lot of cattle will be sold today. But under a Labor government, they'll be more expensive on your dinner plate because they're going to put a tax, their carbon tax will apply on diesel. And so it costs money to get the cattle here and then up the road to Lakes Creek, where something happens to them we won't discuss. And then they end up in your supermarket. And under a Labor Party, everything, rump, scotch fillet, all of these cuts will go up in price because the Labor Party are going to tax our last two oil refineries, and that will push petrol prices up. And who knows what they'll do when they have to do a deal with the Greens. They'll probably tax the methane emissions that apparently are responsible for warming the planet from these cattle. So I don't agree with that. And the Liberal and National Party do not agree with taxes. It's Labor's response to everything. But if you're concerned about your cost of living, if you're concerned about your job, don't vote for a Labor Party and hock with the Greens. It's going to put another carbon tax in place.
And Sarah, can you almost smell the methane emissions from where you're sitting? What do you say to what Matt just said?
You can't. It's odourless. It's odourless.
Well, you know, I'm wearing a boiler suit today in solidarity with our friends in regional Australia. Look, there's a lot to unpack from what Matt has said. You know, Matt, you say you're not too concerned with what the Prime Minister has to say in response to your views, but we all know, without him necessarily picking up the phone to you, that he would not have welcomed your commentary yesterday, because this is exposed divisions within the coalition, and this is something that Barnaby Joyce and Scott Morrison have both seen publicly to sort of appease. There was obviously an agreement brokered last year to agreed to net zero by 2050. The Prime Minister reiterated yesterday it's absolute government policy. I dispute the idea that it's dead. There's absolutely no basis for that. We have to take action on climate change. Clearly both sides of politics have conceded to that. It's been a hard-won battle, but we're there. But I think what's interesting, Matt, is what's the alternative for you? I mean, you are obviously aware that any split on this issue is going to play into the hands of independents in blue-ribbon Liberal seats. states. You are the treasurer of the, your own coalition. Josh Frydenberg risks losing his seat. That's a pattern that's being played out.
Yeah, he's probably even more unhappy with you than Scott Morrison right now, Matt.
Well, this is... I do get a little dispirited when our political commentary always seems to revert back to judging everything as a political horse race. And if you're going to
you're in
do
an election
that,
campaign, as though, Matt. What else are we expected to think?
Well, hang on. Because, as I say, I'm not focused on my job. I'm focused on, well, not necessarily your job, Ali. I'm sure you're doing fine, but I'm focused on the jobs of your viewers. Like, I'm focused on their jobs. And then, as I say, all the political commentary always comes back, talks about, well, which one of us is going to get elected and which one of us is going to get a job? Well, there's only 100, and sort of across the parliament, there's 226 of us in parliament. This tax that Labor, this carbon tax, is going to hit 40,000 jobs here in central Queensland, where I am, 10,000 jobs down in the Hunter Valley, 10,000 jobs more in Western Australia in iron ore and gold and nickel. And again, there's a lot more jobs there. They're just the direct jobs, a lot more direct and indirect jobs there than the 226 people working in Canberra in your nation's parliament.
All right, Matt, I've just got another quick one here for you because I want to get to this. Classroom chaos coming to millions. 2,500 teachers in Victoria face being stood down, supposedly, for refusing the COVID booster. What do you make of that one, Matt?
We've got to scrap these rules. I mean, they're just causing shortages now in our schools and our hospitals. I've been always supportive of the vaccine and the rollout, but it was clear last year and definitely clear now that it's not stopping transmission. It hasn't stopped COVID. So all of these rules and mandates are doing now is exacerbating shortages in our schools and hospitals, and I'd prefer to be treated by a nurse rather than worrying about whether the nurse is vaccinated or unvaccinated right now.
Yeah, I think that might be a sentiment sort of felt by a lot of Australians at the moment. And Sarah, just teachers in New South Wales striking next Wednesday. I mean, this is a nightmare for parents and they do risk losing support.
They do. I mean, I query it as an actual tactic because I think we're finally seeing goodwill towards teachers. And yes, as a parent, my children are back at school today. It does feel like there's one step back. But having said that, the teacher shortage is real. We know that teachers are leaving. They are voting with their feet when it comes to what they call unsustainable workload and underpay. And we do have to take this issue seriously. Governments are going to have to act. Or us parents are not just going to be looking at one day without teachers. We're going to be looking at 365 days without them. Just quickly, my boys think that the teachers might be Star Wars fans because they're striking on May the 4th and he thinks that they all just want to be walking around saying May the 4th be with you. So there you go.
Could be onto something there. And hey, Matt, can I just say, hands off the NRL Grand Final, Queensland.
Bring it to Rocky. We should come to Rockhampton. The finals were great in regional Queensland last year. We should have more of that.
Yeah, I mean, look, it was great to see the game get out and about and see that. But, Sarah...
But, come on. you took it from New South Wales last year. Cut us a break. We've got no teachers next week. We've been in lockdown. Give us our grand final come spring.
Poor old New South Wales,
New South Wales.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, always forgotten. Always forgotten New South Wales.
No one ever talks about us.
No. It's all Queensland.
Exactly. Have you ever heard of the Opera House, Harbour Bridge? No.
Anyway, good to talk to you this morning, Matt. Dropping bombs as always. And Sarah, nice to see you in the studio.
Nice to have Ali.